London, and just behind me is St. Mary Morfield's Church. What makes it so special is it's the only Catholic church in the City of London. Not London, the City of London. The city's financial district.
Compared with other Catholic churches and their architecture, who are very blatant about their identity, and are at least allowed an entrance to themselves, St. Mary Morfield's shares their entrance with two shop fronts. Yes, there is a large sign outside with the word Catholic on it, but that doesn't even face the street. The architecture gives away nothing to the untrained eye.
Now, this is certainly a shadow of the Catholic churches and cathedrals that we know spread across Europe. If we just pan up, nothing about this building really gives away that it is a Catholic church. In fact, it looks very much undermined. But why don't we look inside for the contrast between the two? Let's have a look. From the outside, but so impressive from the in.
A previous chapel had stood in the current location of St. Mary Morfield's in 1686, but was suspended in 1689. This came in the aftermath of what's known as the Revolution of 1688. The law of the City of London has actually existed before that of our own Parliament, showing its incredible influence even to this day. The church has only existed since 1903, and was not even within the City of London itself until 1994. The only reason it sits in the City of London is not by permission, but due to the city extending its size and engulfing what was a small part of the borough of Hackney. The battle against the Catholic Church by the powers that be has mainly gone unseen, even covered up with the imposed impression that the Vatican has any influence in the decisions that we see made across the Christian world, or that it has any voice for the average Christian person of today. But why would a Catholic Church have been missing from the financial capital of the city? For what possible reason would this have taken place? Well, in the year 1534, the Act of Supremacy makes Henry VIII the head of church, which saw Catholicism banned in the United Kingdom during what was described as the English Reformation under the influence of Thomas Cranmer. Cranmer had been involved in building the case for the annulment of Henry's marriage to Catherine of Aragon, to which we know ended badly. upon his predictable failure to persuade a masculine Catholic church, Henry went about destroying all from churches to monasteries in his feud with the Vatican, which led to the creation of the Church of England. The literature of the C of E was created by Cranmer, who was also made the Archbishop of Canterbury and was doing very well for himself as a result.
The story continues when Henry's 9-year-old son, Edward, referred to as the Boy King, reigns for a short time, continuing his father's Protestant goals, but he died in 1553 from what some believe were the conditions of tuberculosis. The young king, while alive, would have been surrounded by Protestant courtiers, or his father's Protestant courtiers, who wanted to continue or where his father had left off, and they would have had their own opinion as to how the political discourse of the time should have been laid out. So at this point, after much political upheaval and a 9-day stint of Lady Jane Grey serving as the Queen, eventually Queen Mary, the daughter of King Henry, takes the throne in 1553. But unlike her father, her sister, or her late monarch of a brother, she was not a Protestant. She was a staunch Catholic. So begins the revenge of the Catholic monarch, who replaces Catholicism as the country's religion once more, and begins to arrest people of influence. The Duke of Northumberland was arrested and beheaded despite him renouncing Protestantism. It seemed that the tables really had been turned.
But in no time at all, things had once more been undone. When Queen Elizabeth I took the throne, much to the relief of the Protestant powers that be. The Elizabethan religious settlements, or the Revolution of 1559, were the names given to the religious and political arrangements made in England during the reign of Elizabeth I, between 1558 and 1603. These brought the English Reformation to a conclusion. The settlement placed Anglicanism as the Christian religion of England. In 1559, a 12-pence fine was handed out to those who refused to go to church. The office for the Catholic clergy was closed for refusing to take the oath of supremacy. Attendance at Catholic Mass was punished by a fine. But the saying of Catholic Mass, or the arrangement for it to be said, carried the death penalty. Pope Pius V in 1570 issued a bull in a papal document against Elizabeth named Regnans in Excelsis. This saw her excommunicated and absolved all of her subjects from allegiance to her and her laws. This was a massive statement and a massive action to have taken place, and one which was certainly not approved of by Philip II of Spain. Thus, the tensions between the world of Catholicism and Protestantism continue and intensify. Skipping forward to the days of Charles I and Oliver Cromwell, who decided for the sake of Protestantism to execute the King of England, following their debates via civil war, shall we say, another turnaround for the Catholic Church took place. Its place in the country and the rights of outside religions, once again, we saw a huge changeover. We saw outside religions take priority within this country. At the same time that Catholicism was being told to leave it. You see, for all Oliver Cromwell's apparent loyalty to Christianity, or to a Christian God, he seemed very quick to undermine an entire church based on that very concept. And he banned the open practice of Catholicism, and making legal once more the banned Jewish religion, who had been made free to make a return to the UK
with religious freedom to build their own religious sanctities or places of worship.
In 1701, an impressive synagogue was erected to replace a previous smaller site named Cree Church Lane Synagogue. Bevis Mark Synagogue is the oldest continuous synagogue to have been in use in the United Kingdom, which is certainly a huge contrast with the Catholic religion, which had been forced into the shadows.
It wasn't until 1791, when Parliament and the Protestant Church truly had hold of power, that the Catholics were allowed back into Britain during the what's known as the Catholic Relief Act. Then came the Act of Emancipation in 1829, finally making Catholics truly legal, or mostly on the same level as non-Catholics, in that they can finally sit as MPs in Parliament. But to this day, there can be no Catholic monarch. So instead of London's financial district building or inviting a Catholic church, it instead only turned up here accidentally. Instead of them saying, please come join us, St. Mary Moorfields only found itself here in 1994 due to the boundary change that took place. And comparing that with other religious buildings which have been here for so long, it certainly points out the victimization or the lack of care for Catholicism. And as a result, we see this half-hidden church built by the architect John Newman. And as I said, it's magnificent inside. But here it stands, not as a guest, but dare I say as an intruder in the eyes of the financial sector of London.
Oliver Cromwell had taken issue with the monarch and had entered the English Civil War on the side of the Roundheads, or the Parliamentarians. He's said to have developed the nickname Old Ironsides due to his ability in battle. His opposition was Charles I, the reigning king, who saw himself as the legitimate monarch, chosen by God and God alone, an idea described as the divine right of kings. After the loss of the English Civil War, Oliver Cromwell was one of the signatories on King Charles I's death warrant in 1649. On this day, he and others committed regicide by having Charles I beheaded, which was a monumental moment in history, sending shockwaves through Europe. His son, Charles II, was forced to flee to Europe, taking with him a deep resentment which would not be forgotten. Cromwell, who is claimed to have been a deeply religious man, now reigns supreme under the title Lord Protector, or Head of State of the Commonwealth of England, Scotland and Ireland, for a 5-year period, making England a republic for the first and only time. He then goes about changing and making laws, such as the penal laws against the Catholics. Cromwell was born into the middle gentry, to a family descended from an advisor and minister to Henry VIII, named Thomas Cromwell. He was sent to take command of the English campaign in Ireland between the years of 1649 to 1650. Cromwell's forces pushed back the Confederate and Royalist coalition in Ireland, taking control of the country and seeing an end to what was called the Irish Confederate Wars. Cromwell also led a campaign against the Army of Scotland between 1650 and 1651, making many enemies on his travels. After changing the shape of England and other countries alike, Oliver Cromwell died of natural causes in 1658 and was buried in Westminster Abbey. He left behind him much controversy and conflict which affects entire countries even to this day, and a name which many people either love or detest. A while later, King Charles II returns to England to take the throne in 1660. He then went about having the corpse of Oliver Cromwell dug up, hung in chains, and beheaded. During the Second Anglo-Dutch War in 1670, Charles entered into what was known as the Treaty of Dover, which was an alliance with his cousin King Louis XIV of France. Louis agreed to help in the Third Anglo-Dutch War and pay him a pension. Charles secretly promised to convert to Catholicism at some point in the future. Charles went about attempting to introduce religious freedoms for Catholics and Protestant dissenters with his 1672 Royal Declaration of Indulgence, but the English Parliament, who was full of the same people who had enjoyed replacing the monarch, forced him to withdraw it. The status of the monarch and their divine right to rule by God had well and truly been undermined and diminished. Despite the apparent power which had just fallen upon Charles, he was left with no power to change anything due to the actions of Oliver Cromwell and the politicians of the time, passing anti-Catholic laws. Charles II was then powerless to facilitate the Catholic Church or aid it in seeking justice. To this day, the monarchy has served to please the Protestant faith whilst allowing Catholicism to endure abuse and isolation. An important question to consider is, if you are said to believe in the kingdom of Christianity, how can you ban the Catholic Church in order to facilitate an outside religion?
So this is Monument Street. Just behind you is the famous Pudding Lane, where the Great Fire of London is said to have begun. And what you are just looking at, what we're looking at, is the monument to the Great Fire of London. But it's more interesting than meets the eye. What many may not know is the blame that the Catholic papacy actually took for starting the Great Fire of London, which was started by anti-Catholic Protestants and the like. The accusation was once on the monument itself, but was chiselled out in 1830, though we see it mentioned on a plaque placed on the side of the monument still today. In 1680, the Court of Common Council ordered that an inscription in Latin and in English be fixed on the monument to signify that the City of London was burnt and consumed with fire by the treachery of the so-called Catholic papists in September in the year of, quote, our Lord. These anti-Catholic markings have been removed several times throughout the years, but certainly leave their stain.
Great Fire of London. But so you don't have to take my word for it, let's quickly have a look at what's written on the side. Now, up here we can see a gap in the writing. You see? You see that gap there? I'm going to show you what it said. And this is the Catholic Church being blamed for the Great Fire of London. But popish frenzy, which wrought such horrors, is not yet quenched. These last words were added in 1681. Bear in mind, the Great Fire of London was 1666. And finally deleted in 1830. Well, they're still here, technically, as is the bad taste in the mouth of the Catholic kingdom, I can imagine. This monument, and what's been scratched out, wasn't necessarily made in respect to the victims, but seems almost like it was made in disrespect to the opposition of the new leadership of Great Britain. So hurt were Catholics at the time, Alexander Pope referred to the monument's effect in a poem.
Were London's columns pointing at the skies like a tall bully lifts the head and lies. So, I'm here at the stunning St. Paul's. Some people find it stunning, other people find it borderline offensive. What makes it so interesting is how the new St. Paul's came about and why it's so different than the old one. The old one was done in a Gothic style, brown, beautiful building. This is very different, and I'll tell you why. Once the papists of Catholicism had received the blame for the Great Fire of London, the monarch and the powers that be went about rebuilding London to benefit them and the new Protestant regime. So this was actually built in an imitation of the Basilica in the Vatican, which isn't so much to compliment, because that's a Catholic kingdom. So what this is, in fact, is a slight towards Catholicism and saying that we are the new head of state. We reject the Vatican, we reject your way of law and religion. We are the head honchos in town. And that's really what the building of St. Paul's was, which was done by Sir Christopher Wren. And to this day, tourists flock from all over the country to come and see it. But I wonder if they're told the stories which we speak of today, and if so, how often. But we can see it's a beautiful chalky white building, which anyone would be right to stop and photograph. But how many people know that it was made in the imitation of what was the head of church at the time, and as a clear act of disrespect, the takeover of power? This building symbolizes not just the power of government, but the power of the hearts and minds of the people.
Benedictus, benedictus.